Speech.
Yes, of course.
So, yep. Mirko, you should activate the voice of Erika, Salvatore, and Günther, please.
I will.
Okay, let's start. welcome to the symposium, Limits of the Human Machines Without Limits, Contemporary State and Robotics Exchanges and Collaborations, which is organized by the Center of Theater Studies of the University of Lausanne with the support of College of Humanities, Chart Laboratory and the Theater Department of the University Paris 8, and the Institute for the Performing Arts and Film of the Zurich University of the Arts. The symposium office is organized by Theo Arnulf and was supported by Stephanie Barbetta in the early stage of the organization. And the Zoom platform is in charge of the team from the Zurich University of the Arts. Let me name Ninja Hoffman, who is the person in charge, and technical assistants, Mirko Leli, Sara Trailovic, Oliver Brunko, and Manuel Leder-Gerber. Of course, we thank all these institutions and collaborators for their work and support. And we thank you, participants, for accepting this online participation, which is a slightly more specific format, sometimes more difficult, but in full health security. This conference gathers an impressive group of participants, 4 keynote speakers, 29 researchers, but also researchers artists from different backgrounds and countries. So thank you for your participation and for being here today and during these 3 days of symposium.
I will take the microphone now and thank you everybody. Good morning, and we hope that despite the physical distances, this symposium will represent an opportunity to share research practices and theoretical reflections about a subject, the convergences between robotics and theater, which to us seems extremely relevant today, and for several reasons. Robots on stage allow the emergence of new, sometimes baffling, aesthetics, which by questioning the place of the human in theater, reflect about the possibility of different ecologies and engage the ethical issues that arise from the development of artificial intelligence and automation. Of course, artificiality, otherness, are at the very core of theater since its origins. But when masks and puppetry are replaced on stage by autonomous intelligent machines, or to say it more precisely, which we perceive as so, because of their behavior, we think that a paradigmatic change occurs. Also, the encounter between arts and science produces new forms of cooperation and creative processes where the logics of the stage and of the laboratory collide, where dramaturgy and programming tend to coincide. And a specific case of this interdisciplinary collaboration concerns social robotics. In this case, creating with robots on stage is a way for both theater artists and roboticists to better understand from different perspectives the human mind and body. So this symposium results from the dialogue and the shared ideas of an interdisciplinary group of researchers gathered by Dr. Isabella Pluta, its lead organizator that I really want to thank for this initiative. And the program of the next 3 days reflects our broad vision as well as our concerns about crossing perspectives and exploring a multitude of scenic and experimental experiences. So thank you.
As you can see,
if I may add something, that emerged from what Erika said, I think that one of the main ambition of this symposium lies in the interdisciplinarity. We want to encourage the interdisciplinary reflection on human-machine interactions and their dramaturgical potentials, with the idea of building shared vocabularies and fostering collaborations between artists and engineers. Theater productions can be seen as an attempt of staging plausible shared models of interpersonal dynamics between humans. And from the point of view of roboticists, this translates into the development of coherent sociocognitive behaviors, no? Able to give the spectators a sort of kind of illusion of life. A feeling of being presence of intelligent and socially conscious creatures. Ishiguro sensei call it sonzaikan, the feeling of being presence of another person. This symposium, we will not focus only on human-like embodiments, but the idea is also to open this reflection to other forms of embodied intelligence, including like wide variety of intelligent machines, like animals, or also chatbots or a virtual agent. And another point is that I think that at the same time, the proposed reflection will focus also on the stage, considered as a privileged space for the study of human behavior, a setting where different technology can also be deployed to capture and model the human sensory motor contingencies. And then from this point of view, the stage becomes an ideal semi-structured environment for the development of metrics, models, techniques, and algorithms able to describe the interaction between the humans and socially intelligent robots. So I think we will be able to explore all these things, these super interesting things in the next today and the next days. And thank you again for being here, for sharing these days together.
As you can see from the program, our invitation was accepted by 4 keynote speakers who are pioneers in this field. Professor Jennifer Parker-Starter and Professor Maike Blicker are researchers who have been working on the relationship between theater and robotics for several years and have authored several publications on the subject as well as research projects. Professor Hiroshi Ishiguro is a robotician pioneer in theater experimentation, who world famous robot Geminoid F was part of Oriza Hirata's theatrical work, but also the subject of several scientific publications. And Professor Zaven Paré, a founder artist who created the electronic puppets in the 90s and is the author of several books dedicated to the contemporary robot. You will see and hear the presentation of 4 keynotes who are the most prominent in this field.
Besides keynotes, the symposium will consist of panels and forums and roundtables. As the panels are taking place in parallel, there will be short reports in the forums later, so you will know what you missed and maybe watch it later because we have a video documentation. And also the forums are meant to inspire discussion, which is probably not possible within the panels, but in the forums it should be possible. because this is, of course, always the vulnerable thing in online conferences. All sessions have their own meeting rooms, Zoom meeting rooms, as you probably have realized. If there are any technical issues, don't hesitate to contact the digital assistants whose email addresses you received in the invitation mail. Today, this is Mirko. Mirko, can you make yourself seen for a second so we know who you are? This is Mirko. Hello, Mirko. Thank you very much for assisting. And there's a different day host every day. You all have this information. I will close with a couple of words on the content again, but it's all been said before. The theater has always embraced new technologies and tried to understand in performative settings what they could possibly mean for humans. The fascination for automats, machines, robots, and digital agents has created a multitude of narratives that in reverse lead to the construction of machines to stage and embody them. So fiction and reality inspire each other in a complicated way. And we hope the symposium will add to the complexity of this interconnection and dive into the strange friendship of art, theater, and technology. This is what we wanted to set up. And now enjoy the symposium. I think we are a little early for the first presentation. What should we do with the left minutes, Isabella?
I think we can stay connected in this room, and Jennifer could prepare her PowerPoint. And if the participant have questions, they could ask to Mirko, and we restart at 10. Yeah, it is okay for you. So if you wish, you can check the mute micro, and yes, you can take your coffee. Jennifer, if you wish, you can share your screen already.
I think I've been sharing the wrong screen. Hold on. Okay, Isabella, can you see just the screen now?
Yes, yes, I see it.
Okay, great.
Maybe I would like just to say that this online solution with Zooms could be sometimes complicated. Don't hesitate to contact us and the assistants. And we are connected on emails and on WhatsApp. And if you have a small late, it's not a problem. Just to ensure you that we are here and we will organize all this conference, all this symposium. Yes. So can we start? Yeah, okay. I'm very happy that Jennifer, you accepted this invitation. We will hear your talk today, your keynote speaker. And let me present now your biography, your scientific biography. You are the head of the School of Performing Arts and Digital Media at Royal Holloway University of London. You are author of Cyborg Theatre, maybe the book the most known, Corporeal Technological Intersection in Multimedia Performance, but also Performance and Media Taxonomies for a Changing Field, which was co-authored with Sarah Bay Cheng and David Saltz, and also co-editor of Performing Animality, Animals in Performance Practices with Lourdes Orozco, and your essay, Animal Ontologies and Media Representations, Robotics, Puppets, and the Real of Warhols, which was published in Theater Journal in 2013, received the Association for Theatre and Higher Education Award in 2014 for outstanding article. Your essays and reviews have appeared in several specialized journal, theater journal. Let me quote theater journal or a journal of performer, performance and art. Also women and performance, theater topics, international journal of performance, arts and digital media, for instance. You served as the editor of theater journal from 2015 and 2019. And you are a contributing editor to a journal of performance and art, but also for the International Journal of Performing Arts and Digital Media. And you are also advisory board member of Antenne, the Journal of Nature and Visual Culture. You are also a team leader for StoryLab, the grant of the RHC Creative Clusters Program Story Futures. And your keynote talk today, as you can see on screen, is entitled Limits of the Non-Human, Cyborgs, Technologized Animality, and Boundary Crossings. So dear Jennifer, you have 45 minutes, and after we have 15 minutes for our questions, please.
Okay, thank you so much, thank you. Thank you, thanks to Isabella and the other conference organizers for this invitation. I hoped we could all meet in person by now, but perhaps turning to the technological is fitting for a conference about robots. I thought to turn myself into a robot for this talk, a la Thomas Mella in Rimini Protocol's Uncanny Valley, but I thought the voice might be very grating after a while. So I suppose my Zoom face will have to do. Robots are everywhere. In industry, entertainment, service industries, and of course, theater and performance. And please do tell me if you can't see the slides moving or if there's any kind of glitch, and I will just try to correct it. The first time I think I saw a robot on stage was in 2002 in Richard Maxwell's production, Joe. It was a complete surprise to see the character Joe, who we'd seen grow up through five separate monologues delivered by five actors of different ages, to finally emerge as a robot. In this production, the rather crude by today's standards, human-sized robot rolled out as the sixth stage of the man's life. Maxwell's style has at times been considered flat or robotic, with actors foregoing psychological realism for an atonal delivery, and the robot's voice perfectly extended the tone the actors had been using. But beyond stylistic choices, this piece also asks questions about the then technologization of humanity, concepts that in 2002, still 5 years prior to the first iPhone, were far less assimilated than they are today. In 2002, seeing a robot in any capacity was not the norm. Depending on your definition of robot as an automated machine, whether industrial or human or animal shaped, or a machine to replace or assist human effort, it is always, as this audience most certainly knows, stemming from the Carol Čapek play, RUR, Rossum's Universal Robots from 1920, in which the Czech word roboti is often translated as work, forced labor or servitude. Now, RUR wasn't about robots as we know them at all, but about human labor. In the text, the robot is created by and in service to human makers, and in the end rises up against the humans. But the robots in the text were made up of some kind of batter, as one of the translations says. So they might be more like what we might consider synths today. Indeed, carrying on the tradition is a recent piece I was made aware of just last month in the Belgrade International Theater Festival called A Future Fortune, by Dragana Belut, which takes RUR as its premise, and she directly on stage works alongside the humanoid robot to rebel against labor exploitation. Robots have been making more and more stage debuts, and by now we have examples of so many. This program is full of them, from Rimini Protocol's lifelike robot in Uncanny Valley, to the groundbreaking Geminoid F and others created by Hiroshi Ishiguro's lab, or through the robotic work of Christopher Donk, or Louis-Philippe Demer, or the exquisite and humanless piece by Heiner Goebbels, Stifter's Dinger, and many others, as we will hear in the next 3 days. While I need not trace the appearances of robots on stage here, and for an account of this, you might see the, our conference participant Louise Lepage's blog, Robot Performance. She does an excellent account of robots in theater on stage. The point that I'm making is that theater and performance have always embraced developing technology, and explorations with robots are no exception. As Christoph Bartnek described in some conference proceedings called Robots in the Theater and Media, theater is a good place to examine robots because they are, quote, are constrained to the current state of art in robotics and are therefore closer to what robots will look like in the close future, end quote. Which is to say, while robots can easily be CGI'd in film, when live, we see their successes and their failures. Let's see if this can work. Just a quick. It might take a minute to load these videos. I don't know if they're worth it. Let's see.
To be able to walk with a number of different gaits. Here it's walking, here it's pacing. Pacing is lateral, legs is pairs. Uh-oh. There it's failing.
Okay. In this 100 years since RUR fueled our imaginations, and in the past 2 decades, when their reality and performance has become increasingly interesting to explore, the notion of the robot and what is roboticized has transformed to a reality that can further allow us to examine how the human and non-human relate, interact, and increasingly rely upon each other. My research continues to be driven by, by attempts to rethink subjectivity through human technological intersections as a cyborg theater, which is the name of my first book, and has since evolved to develop the cyborg theater through a triangular relationship between technologies, humans, and non-humans, and especially non-human animals, in art, performance, installation, VR, and robotics. This shifting research terrain has allowed me to become attuned to the many practices that involve and include the non-human, and specifically non-human animals. As scholars such as Akira Mizuta-Lippitt and Nicole Shukin have argued, animal bodies and lives are intricately interwoven with the new and old technologies, with biopolitics, with capital. In Shukin's influential book, Animal Capital, she argues that the phrase animal capital materially invests in a world in which species boundaries can be radically crossed as well as reinscribed in the genetic and aesthetic pursuit of new markets. Now, crossing species boundaries has led me to posit a technological species. And given the advancements in robotics and AI, this encompasses robots. It is through these interrogated crossings that we become attuned to the non-human and more open to the presence of the non-human forces collaborating with us in the world. To arrive at this position, I trace a lineage of that I'm posing as technologized animality, which is a term that I'm using to encompass the way humans see, use, and understand different animal species through technologies. It's a condition in which humans, non-human animals, and technologies are placed in relation to each other, whether as separate entities, such as the robot figure, or in what I would call cyborgian mergings. And I want to argue that we need to expand these parameters to find ways to give voice an agency to the non-human, technologized animals in our midst. In Politics of Nature, Bruno Latour theorizes a new kind of political ecology and proposes a collective to replace dualities of politics and nature in which both humans and non-humans can act and be represented. For Latour, humans and non-humans should be in association, a term used to overcome a subject-object division, in which its members have the potential to modify each other. This is a modification I strive to identify in what I have called a becoming animate. I've defined this as a condition of sensory attunement, palpable and vibrant, that reveals the interrelationships and traces left between animal, human, and machine. I'm of course playing upon Deleuze and Guattari's well-known becoming animal as I consider their concept in relation to the animal always already enmeshed with technological processes, animate. Becoming's animate might produce a reverberating kind of sensation, a retracing, or in Deleuze and Guattari's words, a contagion back to the human hand. My hope is that this might produce a kind of relational thinking that assigns more agency to the non-human animal actor. Latour points to this agency when he writes, "As soon as we stop taking the non-humans as objects, as soon as we allow them to enter the collective in the form," this is the part I love, "of new entities with uncertain boundaries, entities that hesitate, quake, induce perplexity, it is not hard to see that we can grant them the designation of actors." It is perhaps advances in robotics from machinic to automaton to animatronic to AI futures of thinking with humans that will transform these human-centric practices towards more interreliant forms. So I want to frame the non-human animal and its robotic counterpart as actor. Robotic animal agents then might provide new techniques, as Jane Bennett has expressed, quote, "in speech and art and mood to disclose the participation of non-humans in our world," end quote. I will propose three different layers of animal mechanization: mimetic appropriation in automata and robotic forms, biomimetic participation in learning processes, and collaborative co-design in artistic processes. And while not just theater and performance, this is a very interdisciplinary talk, I want to identify where these species crossings might bring the non-human into a more collective association that offers room for non-human robotic animal agency. So, in three parts. Part one, mimetic appropriation. Out of the 100 plus robots at the 2017 Robots exhibition at London's Science Museum, what caught my eye were the non-human entities. This, the decorative mechanical silver swan from 1773, that when wound up, preens itself and gracefully moves its neck to catch fish. And this, the automaton spider from 1604. The text there reads, "The shiver-inducing spider could scuttle across a table and cause a fright, having been wound up so that the legs would be moved by a tiny mechanism. It was made during the early lifetime of philosopher René Descartes." Descartes later distinguished people from animals, controversially arguing that while we both had bodies and souls, animals had only their bodies. They were mere automatons. Here's a close-up of the spider. This spider machine automata is, of course, an object, a mimetic appropriation of what Descartes called animals, natural automata. In Animals Are Machines, Descartes explains his theory that animals cannot think or have a soul. He said, "I know that animals do many things better than we do, but this does not surprise me. It can be used to prove that they act naturally and mechanically, like a clock, which tells the time better than our judgment does." This notion, comparing animal nature to that of a clock, set up a problematic future for animal-human relations, but also highlights an animal technological split that continues today in robotics, where a trend has been to build mechanical models based on animal bodies to enact human-driven goals such as surveillance or warfare. As Kara Riley has posed in her book, Automata and Mimesis on the Stage of Theater History, quote, "The ultimate referent for any mimetic act is the human or the animal body. But our impressions of what reality is and how it functions are directly linked to how it is represented. Mimesis is a force that shapes reality," end quote. But whose reality is being shaped through these imitations? And why bother to use the animal body at all? When researching animal robotics, you find a lot of inspiration taken from animal movements, such as, see if we can get, this is the bionic wheelbot. which is shaped like a crab and walks like a crab. And then also they made it so that it can roll. And complete with the dramatic music, I think that really helps it. But, or the, let's see, we've got the bionic kangaroo, which is also based on the kangaroo movement. And as far as I can tell, it really just seems to hop. And I love the fact that they use the bionic sounds of the bionic woman, right? That sound that I struggled to capture in the opening of my book. Okay, in my 2013 essay, Animal Ontologies and Media Representations, Robotics, Puppets, and the Reel of Warhorse, I opened with a hummingbird drone being introduced to a crowd by Regina Duggan in a TED Talk. Duggan, the then 19th director of the US's DARPA agency, was using it to answer the rhetorical question, what would you attempt to do if you knew you could not fail? This question epitomizes the human exceptionalism implicit in many animal-based robotic explorations. Capture the animal body mechanically and then use it to service human needs. This hummingbird was introduced as a highly maneuverable tool with many possibilities. A lot of money is put into the development of these animal robots to appropriate animal bodies for their movement capacities. For example, the DARPA Big Dog robot or the Mule robot, which were designed to carry heavy loads. These robots are about human progress and need and maintain an inspired reverence for the qualities we wish to appropriate, but at the same time seem to bracket off other parameters about the animal, such as its head, for example, in order to make the robots a success. A better question to pose might be a reversal of Duggan's question. That is, what would or could we attempt to do if we acknowledge our failures and take time to learn from and value the non-human animals inspiring these innovations? Just checking here. Our hearts go out to that convulsing dog, I think, in the video, but that example is less about the dog itself and more about replicating its movement patterns, which there failed clearly. These big dog robots and the mule drones failed as well because they were far too loud to carry gear in combat terrains. The movement has always been the main objective of mimetic appropriation strategies, from bird flight to harnessing quadrupedalism, from mimicking the serpentine and rectilinear movements of a snake, to capturing the hopping movements of the kangaroos. Humans are capitalizing on animal bodies. Like the hummingbird, insects provide another fascination due to their small size and their ability to go into spaces that humans cannot. The development of insect drones are still a ways from being implemented successfully, but many offer an encouraging model for mimetic appropriation that spotlights not only their movement pattern, but also allows for a deep focus into their biology and behavior that draws attention to issues such as climate change. One example, there are several being developed, but I'm just going to focus on one, are the robo-bees in development at the Weiss Institute at Harvard, which are lighter in weight than the hummingbird and described as, quote, insect-inspired robots with potential uses in crop pollination, search and rescue missions, surveillance, and as well as high-resolution weather, climate, and environmental monitoring. Their website remarks that they are inspired by the biology of a fly. Robo bees achieve vertical takeoff, hovering, and steering, end quote. The mechanics of this development are remarkable, and researchers have discussed how much effort has been invested to learn how to achieve the actual flight and maneuverability. Let's see here.
I am energized by the potential of an autonomous device that thinks on its own. It could impact everything from crop pollination to search and rescue. And that's science, not fiction.
So you can see how it moves there. I'm interested in the deep engagement with the actual living animal that has to happen to achieve this range of flight parameters. This level of intensity needed to replicate the insect's movement and the length of time spent studying them has the possibility of producing a becoming animate in the human researcher. Each attempt may bring them closer to the animal or insect itself. There are long-term projects. These are long-term projects that have required a lot of trial and error. In a video from National Geographic, Robert Wood, the core faculty member at the Institute, ends by saying, "How many robo-bees have we crashed? All of them. We build, we test, we build, we test. If you don't fail, you don't learn enough, end quote. This sense of being willing to fail, to take time, and to learn from these robotic animal agents has potential to counter the mere mimetic appropriation of many of these experiments. To fly like a bee, humans have to think like a bee. Many bio-inspired mimetic appropriations, while still in development, have actually provoked the fear of their successes. The science and the fiction are actually inevitably intertwined. Like Jane Bennett's examples of the interconnectedness of things in her book, Vibrant Matter, these things can be considered lively or dangerous. Already these insect drones are controversial figures, generating speculation about their indetectability, the fear that they might surveil or take DNA samples. Here's where the real and the fiction get interwoven. Fiction, usually a step ahead of public knowledge, is already producing these fears. Take, for example, the episode of Black Mirror called Hated in the Nation, in which autonomous drone insects are programmed to kill. Or another episode, Metalhead, that shows the dystopic side to such robotic animal figures, in which a dog robot is programmed to relentlessly pursue its enemy and kill its prey. In this case, humans who resist the system. But perhaps this is where the filmic fiction does not represent the actual state of current robotics. While I don't doubt the nefarious possibilities of these drone animals as they develop, there are, for example, already worried sightings of robotic bees that turn out to just be dragonflies. Because in actuality, they are extremely hard to create due to the complications of aerodynamics at such a small scale, and because wind flow presents a huge engineering challenge. That and the real problem of something so expensive being swallowed by birds. So in theater, drones are beginning to appear, but perhaps the most famous example thus far, Cirque du Soleil's Paramore, is far from creating a threat outside of maybe the health and safety concerns of these things flying around and being out of control, but it's hard to be afraid of a flying lampshade. This is just to say that all these things already have an agency that provokes us, and they're being understood conceptually, both positively and negatively because of it. In the age of the Anthropocene, bee populations are being decimated, and the turn to animal robots, while potentially able to exist to assist existing bees and pollinate alongside them, is only necessary because of the heavy human hand. In the case of these robo-bees, humans are learning from actual bees to solve some of the problems which humans have created. Their development might be a step towards adjusting a balance in which the actual bees could be assisted by their robotic counterparts. Part two, biomimetic participants. I'll start with this slide. Humans frequently exploit nature to design better robots. And we occasionally design robots to increase our understanding of nature. By simulating biological entities, robots can shed light on natural selection, animal physiology, biomechanics, and behavior without humans ever having to interact with living organisms. Within the last section, I explored non-human animals that were replicated robotically, largely because of their structural frames and movement patterns. As a tool for human use, some of these mimetic replacements were divorced from their animal natures and just put in service to humans. Although there is room for humans to learn through observed study, in this next section, the humans, non-human animals, and their technological counterparts are a step closer, interacting, placing the animal and the robots into a participatory role. So interactive robots interact with living systems. And in a 2020 article, Interactive Biorobotics, author Eduardo Dotteri looks at the methodologies in a range of studies using interactive robotic models in animal research, saying that robots can exert transitory or even permanent influence on the behavior of animals and humans is obvious. Surrounding living systems are likely to be temporarily or permanently affected by their behavior. This notion of influence is critical for my thinking. Whether animals should be used by humans is a larger debate, but within many human and non-human animal entanglements, I'm looking for these sites of exchange and of influence. They're not equal exchanges, of course, but in this section, the robots, both non-representational and realistic, not only interact with, but are also able to influence the non-human animals as interspecies participants in the studies. In Robots and the Service of Animal Behavior, researchers Barrett, et cetera, explain that physical models have long been used in the study of animal behavior, describing some of the many forms these models have taken, such as bizarre, impossible taxidermy of predatory birds, fake chameleon heads on sticks, horse mannequins, zebra costumes, glass beads as termite eggs, et cetera. These are among the hordes of the physical non-robotic models that have been effectively placed among living animals at the service of animal behavior. I mention these examples to note that the mimicry described here is in relation to behavior rather than movement. And the robotic non-human animal may or may not need to be a realistic representation of the animal itself, much like the robot Joe on stage didn't need to move like the humans to be understood as Joe. The two examples I want to share in this section are ones in which behavior is studied, one a behavioral study with cockroaches, and the robotic insect takes a non-realistic form, and the other an entertaining TV show where the robotic animatronic animal counterparts are hyper-realistic. Both are placed into environments with living animals and offer possibilities for behavioral exchange. Still, and always looping back to the human, the shift towards interactive robotics is one in which researchers may begin to learn about the non-human animals from the perspective of a version of the animal itself. In these studies, the interdisciplinary researchers, from entomologists to zoologists to roboticists, attempt to bring the animal and robotic behaviors more in sync by designing robotic participants for these studies based on the animal behavior. What is possible if living and robotic agents work together? In what is being called mixed societies, non-human animals are learning relationally from robotic versions of themselves. These robotics emerge from the field of biomimetics, or the imitation of biological processes. By focusing on relationality and behavior, boundaries between the human, non-human, and technological begin to become more porous and offer deeper possibilities of interspecies learning. I will focus on one ongoing study from 2007 called Social Integration of Robots in Groups of Cockroaches to Control Self-Organized Choice, where researchers Jay Halloy et al. Described the experiment. Our experimental setup consists of a circular arena endowed with two shelters. In the presence of two identical shelters, large enough to host the entire group, all the cockroaches chose collectively to rest under one of the shelters. When one shelter is darker than the other, cockroaches select the darker shelter. Now, robotic cockroaches, these white squares there, called insbots, were introduced to the living roaches to try to alter the shelter selection behavior. These robots were not mimetic reproductions, clearly, but biomimetically designed to affect the behavior of the living cockroach. They did not look at all like the animals because cockroaches respond at a molecular pheromonal level, the robots were designed with this in mind. The research explains that cockroaches carry on their cuticle a blend of molecules that represent their identity. Acceptance of robots within a cockroach group is related to the ability of robots to bear the correct chemical signal. Therefore, robots were conditioned with the cockroach recognition pheromone. So this was one of the first studies using interactive animal robotics. And although cockroaches on their own gravitate to the darker shelters, when the robotic roaches were introduced and programmed to go to the lighter shelter, the behavior of the live cockroaches was changed so that they also went to the lighter shelter. In an essay about an earlier stage of this project, Shoshana Magnet emphasizes the relational possibility of this work. Biomimetic studies based on relationality might enable more of an exchange and less of a replication. What questions, Magnet asks, help us to consider the permeable boundaries between insects and machines, end quote. This assumption of a permeable boundary is where biomimetics and studies like this begin to influence relationships with the non-human, to learn from each other and become more attuned to each other's movements, chemical makeup, and behaviors. The living roaches were influenced behaviorally by their robotic counterparts. While these influences are currently unidirectional, the robot agents influencing the behavior of the living animal, researchers suggest that influences such as AI will shift this balance, explaining that, quote, there is still much room for improvement and adoption of interactive robots. Advances in robotics and machine learning will allow the next generation of interactive robots to learn optimal behavioral responses. All of the agents in these studies are capable of learning. So if the animal is learning from AI, it is logical that AI will also learn from the behavior of the animal. The biomimetic qualities of the InSpot were not visual representations, but rather accepted through their pheromones. However, the issue of biomimetic realism becomes more critical when attempting to observe animals in environments without human influence. In this next scenario, the human is replaced by the animal robot, and this, as in the case with the BBC PBS TV series, Spy in the Wild. The lifelike robots created for this television series are constructed according to the promotional material to, quote, travel the world to understand the true nature of animals they meet, end quote. Including robotic otter and spy crocodile hatchlings, spy egrets living alongside elephants, meerkats, and wild dog pups, these episodes show extraordinary advances in animal robotics that can be placed alongside actual animals and be accepted in environments in which humans would alter the behaviors. These robotic animal agents become a prosthetic eye through which humans can take a step back and observe without disturbing. These spies serve a dual purpose. They are visually made for television entertainment and are fitted with high definition cameras for eyes. But what these eyes reveal has also been reported to astound anthropologists who can see through the cameras in closer proximity to the animal colonies than usually possible. Scientists, zoologists, biologists make up the design team, aiming for as realistic an approximation in visual look as well as eye and facial movement. Designers explain that while the look and the movement must be meticulous to be accepted into the animal environments, they also focus carefully on the behaviors of the animal and learn from the scientists. They describe the details around the spy turtle. As you can see, the spy turtle looks incredibly realistic and even gulps like real turtles. She can walk, move her head with a camera in the eye, and even lay spy eggs, her own batch of eggs with cameras inside. So what I'd like to argue here is if we can see through their eyes, perhaps we can see them better through our own. The data being collected through these robotic animals on television is already being used in studies and is remarkable in seeing certain animal behavior for the first time because the robotic animals are accepted where the humans are not. Let's see here. Here's a little example. You can see this online, but it's kind of cool to see how they do it. can keep watching, but it's tempting. These seem like extraordinary developments that will likely have deeper impact when removed from just the television context. Head of Natural History Commissioning for BBC, Tom MacDonald, comments that, quote, in particular, the series sheds a light on the similarities in behavior between animals and humans. Endowing animals with human emotion used to be frowned upon by scientists, but that has changed over the past 10 years. You can't spend any time with animals without realizing that so much of what they do is like us. It's inevitable, really. We are animals, end quote. And that we are. And this inevitability may well always create relational structures in which humans remain dominant. However, perhaps my argument, seeing through the eyes of the robotic animals to better see the actual animals, will remind us of and reinforce our similarities rather than our differences. Getting a literal bird's eye view into animal behaviors may facilitate new forms of interspecies communication. Part three, collaborative co-design. In this final section, and perhaps still the most elusive, the technologized non-human actor moves from mimetic replacement and biomimetic participant in human studies to a closer role of co-designer. In all of these cases thus far, the living animals are already technologized, as I set out initially, and across the talk, the triangulation between the three elements becomes more interreliant. Here, perhaps because this moves us into an art and performance realm, the elements resonate more equally, if not ideally, but there is an attempt to acknowledge the technologized animality as itself. Art and performance may be more likely to remove the need for outcomes than scientific studies, and certainly brings the non-human actor into closer conversation and relationality with the human. So this is where I have so far found the most fruitful possibility for reflection, for change, for interrelational thinking. However, my hope is that with the next generation of artists and scholars and scientists, that the ideas of collaboration and co-design might bring the non-human animal into focus as a partner worthy of greater agency. I turn to the concept of co-design, a concept that has emerged from the field of design and depicts a collaborative creative process with stakeholders. It's a creative design process that's been applied to various models, researchers and communities, adults and children and others. It's not a term generally used to define performance or art making processes or to apply to human and non-human animal participants, but I'm using it here because as a method and process, it seeks to put participants on a more level playing field. In co-design as collaborative research, authors Zaminopoulos and Alexiou explain that co-design activity produces new knowledge as people develop and experiment with new ideas around a matter of concern as they engage in negotiations around the development of ideas. In this process, as the authors state, the position is about sharing ideas. And this for me implies that in order to solve complex problems, we must listen to all involved. So if we face a future of climate change, of increasing zoonotic pandemics, or just outrageously outdated practices of treating animals, then those non-human animals whose lives are impacted or taken because of these practices must be represented. While there are many examples of artists working with animals in performance, theater, and art, I want to conclude today with one example because of its attention to the three elements of my inquiry: the human, the non-human animal, and the technological. I've been working with artist Du Sung Yu for several years now, writing about his extraordinary work, which indeed introduces the Latourian, quote, new entities with uncertain boundaries, end quote. Yu has developed and performed with a range of what he calls organ-machine hybrids that challenge the boundaries between human, animal, and machine. Here we see the Aqua001 CO2 robotic pig heart jellyfish and the installation called Lai robotic cow tongues. In these works, the animal is not always mimetically representational, but often abstracted and evoking. I'm going to put this on behind me. The beginning is a little bit, it could be disturbing if you're a vegetarian, so just be aware. I'm not going to put the sound on. I'm just going to leave it on mute. I have argued elsewhere that these works almost force the world of the animal into focus. It is hard to unsee some of these entities, and they provoke questions about the use of animals in science, technology, art, and ultimately evoke in me a trace of the animal left behind. And through their complex entanglements with performance and technology, they challenge concepts of technologized animality. In this, the Aqua001 robotic pig heart jellyfish, a real pig heart is reanimated within this robotic machine with human hair emulating jellyfish tentacles. This new entity complicates the technologization processes between humans and animals, such as xenotransplantation, interspecies research, and genetic modification. It is not solely a technological mimetic representation of a jellyfish or a biomimetic participant, but rather or almost a collaboration. Although I say this with caution, given the lack of agency of the individual elements, but it floats, you know, alongside the fish in a collaboration made by the human, Du Sung Yu. A project like this illuminates for me quite clearly the problematic extent to which these lines between the elements might be blurred, but it also illuminates the possibility of an interanimation between all of the elements. These new entities are beyond object and not quite subject, but challenge us to critically identify and readdress human relationships with non-humans. Yu's recent piece moves from the strictly robotic, but here exemplifies, this next piece is not robotic, but moves into the space of VR, which I'm also working in terms of the technologization. And I want to bring this up. It's called Becoming Leeches, Having Dinner. In this, he pushes the robotic hybrid work further into a complex triangulation of the human-animal technological through a performance VR installation work, in which he puts it, quote, humans interact with live and animated leeches to forge a necessary alliance to arrive at a better world, end quote. In this work, live audiences feed live leeches from the meat that the chef, played by Yu, gives them. And this act generates virtual leeches, all supporting survival for the others within the experience. Within this VR game, the player becomes a leech flying through the air away from a polluted world towards a utopic island. A video is available on his website along with details about the rest of his work. Although Yu doesn't refer to his work as co-designed, he created this piece with a conscious attention to how the leeches, both living and animated, perform. And like their robotic counterparts in the other examples, they cannot express their collaboration and thus cannot be seen to be co-designers from a human perspective, yet they are represented by Yu. Within Latour's notion of the collective, what is crucial is that the non-human is represented, speaking through a spokesperson even. In Yu's work, these technologized animals are represented within an interspecies environment of reliance and hospitality. Yu's work seeks to understand, interpret, and address how interspecies relations might be more careful, how we gain empathy for or turn toward the non-human animal and its technological counterpart. He asks, quote, might it be possible to reassess traditional relationships and reinterpret animals in new relational stages alongside advanced technology? Could we create two-way communications rather than stubbornly holding on to one-way relationships with animals, end quote? To be open to two-way communication, the complex relationship between human, non-human animal and the technological has to be foregrounded and analyzed. In so doing, through mimetic appropriation, biomimetic participation, and into a process of co-design, the concept of technologized animality may become less human-centric and includes these robotic animal agents of change. My hope is that by understanding these unruly agents as actors in a complex theater of the world, we take a risk towards a more ethical and environmentally aware future. And I just want to end with a little bit of fun. Okay, thank you very much for your time and attention today.
Okay, thank you very much, dear Jennifer, for this fascinating keynote talk, which is an excellent introduction to our symposium, and which precises a lot of important questions for our 3 days about our society composed of human and non-human entities. So we can open our discussion. Mirko, if you are here, I would like to be sure, how can we proceed? Can we just do the sign with our hand, or sign our question in the discussion?
There are different possibilities, so I can just let people unmute themselves if you want.
Okay.
Or with the hand, I guess.
Okay.
Or both also works.
Yes. So maybe I can start with the first question.
Pointed out rightfully, the chat is also a possibility to write questions down.
Okay, so my question is, I was thinking during your presentation about the which could be the next step in this research, in this artistic experimentation with these new entities. What do you think? What could be the next step?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I think that I'm really interested in the work and the talks that are going to come after me, because I think there are some great experts out there who are going to be able to share and shed light on the next steps. From an observational perspective, I think I'm interested in the exchange, in where the technological species, if you will start to have some more agency to be able to work together with the human in different capacities. I mean, I think that some of the examples of robotic theater, like the Stifter's Dinge, which I think someone's going to be talking about at some point, you know, that piece had no humans at all, but it was a relational experience with the audience. So there was definitely some kind of exchange going on. And for me, I'm really interested in what that means, and how, not just what that means in terms of like advances in AI, you know, and the kind of smarter computer systems and algorithms, but in terms of what it means for us as humanity to merge somehow with these technological beings, which I think have been so human focused that we really want them to be, doing the things that we want them to do. But I'm really interested in the moments of failure and in the moments when they don't do what we want them to do, but that can create some positive exchanges. So I don't know, I couldn't tell you what the next thing would be, but I'm really interested in seeing what develops on stage. And the idea that the stage can be a place that has more actual application, you know, performance and art practices where we can see what's actually happening. Because I think we get really taken away by what we see on TV and film, because that's not realistic. So I'm really interested in what is happening on stage, and also just beyond the human, you know, like I, you know, obviously like that last clip shows great advancements in terms of movement possibilities for these robotic agents. But I'm sort of interested in also like other forms of non-human merging. So it's not really a great answer to your question, but it's just amusing on where I think, you know, where my interests are anyway.
Yes, thank you very much. There are some questions for Professor Jennifer Parker-Starbucks. Yes, Günther, you should activate your
microphone. Thank you very much, very inspiring. I was wondering about the word species, because some people tend to think of robots as a new form of, as a new species. And I'm wondering how you are thinking about this, because what you addressed is the mimicking, the robots mimicking different species and even get accepted by that species. So kind of trick the species into thinking that they are part of the species, something like that, which is something like theater actually. But do you think of robotic agents as a new species?
I think why I'm trying to pose this sort of the notion of a technological species, because there's clearly that inscribes some agency to them, right? So it's that I want to take them seriously. I don't want them just to be robots, right? I don't want them to be like thought of as the machines that we create. You know, I think that there is a sense of agency in these, this is what I'm trying to get at, right? That there's a sense of agency in these works that we have, that if we could kind of respect them in that sense as their own thing, right? I mean, clearly these are all human driven, but then they become like that pig heart jellyfish, or when those tongues move, it's totally strange and uncanny. There is something that they hold, this kind of sense that they hold, that I think if we could look at that as a species in its own sense, these technologized species, then we might be able to think about them in a different way, and not just kind of from a dominating perspective, but a real integrated exchange. So I'm using the word specifically to ascribe this agency to them. Which I think probably many people in the room today also understand that from their own work, that these are obviously it's not just about the human is what I'm trying to say, I guess, right? I really want to have us think outside our own species in that sense. Because I mean, obviously I work in animal studies also. So there's a whole element to my work that has a sense of looking at other at the non-human in a different way, and trying to understand that differently, and not just from a dominating perspective. And I feel like we need to do more of that in terms of the current crisis in the world. You know, from the pandemic to the environmental crisis, really we have to do that. And so, you know, these are the areas in which I think we could influence and nuance our thinking. I don't know if that answers your question. Thank you for the question.
Other questions? We have 3 minutes. If you see the hand, tell me, please.
Esther, yeah.
Esther, yes, please.
Yes, hi, for this inspiring, very inspiring presentation. I was wondering about entities and species. What do you think about half organic and half not organic hybrid processes on stage, for example, talking about non-human objects? Are they new entities too? I don't know if you know Marco Donnarumma, the performers who use this mechanical arm and artificial intelligent processes covered by a synthetic skin and its hair. So yeah. Use this kind of entity, object. So what do you think about this?
Well, my research really is all about cyborgs, right? So that kind of the organic and non-organic merging is what is most fascinating to me. And mostly, my book is all about the introduction of media and technology on stage in the turn of the last century, right? So like when we started to how the bodies can relate to each other, the human bodies and the technological bodies, if you will. But so obviously that is a realization, it sounds like, of the actual sort of cyborg entity that when I was writing my book was really about theater and about more of a theorizing, not that we weren't at that stage, other than maybe someone like Stell Ark, you know, who was putting artificial, ears on himself and working with machines. But there really weren't so many people at that time doing kind of putting the actual entities on stage. But I'm very interested in it, but I'm also cautious, right? In the sense that like, when I talk about the pig heart jellyfish in more depth, I question, and I've asked, I've talked to the artist quite a lot about the ethical dimensions. I mean, he's using a pig heart that he got from a butcher shop. He doesn't, he's a vegetarian. Like there's a kind of sense that, the use of the animal is itself problematic, but in his case, it makes you question the use of the animal, right? And I think that that's fascinating. I hope that I'll learn more about that, those entities, because they sound just exactly the kind of thing that I'm very interested in. But I also want to think about what that means. What does it mean for us to be creating those entities? What can we learn from that? It's so that I'm interested in it beyond sort of gimmickry, beyond like, ooh, look what we can do and how cool, but what is it that we are learning as humans about these non-humans that can help us to maybe shape a better future for non-human and the non-human world? So I look forward to hearing more about that, Esther. Thank you for your question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I don't see